Good morning, everybody. At the outset, I'd like to thank the committee members of the ISOPS for giving me this opportunity to share with you my experiences with minimally invasive endocrine surgery and the lessons I learned over this wonderful journey. There are no conflicts of interest. Difficult roads often lead to beautiful destinations. And at the end of this beautiful journey, we'll see the beautiful destination that was achieved. Minimal invasive surgery describes a field of surgery that crosses all traditional disciplines. It's not a discipline into itself, but it's more of a philosophy of surgery, a way of thinking. That is very important if one has to become a laparoscopic surgeon. So it is the ability to perform traditional surgical procedures in a novel way using high-tech imaging systems. And this helps to minimize the trauma of surgical exposure from the patient's point of view. During the last 20 years, laparoscopic surgery has turned the surgical world upside down. And in the operating rooms around the world, the lights have gone out and the surgeons are operating in the dark. So much so that there are now two types of surgeons, laparoscopic surgeons whose waiting lists are becoming longer, and non-laparoscopic surgeons whose patients are becoming fewer and fewer, unfortunately. Laparoscopy undoubtedly represents a revolution in modern surgery, providing great advantages, especially from the patient's point of view. Now, it's important to realize that this transition to laparoscopy first began in dedicated surgical centers without any standardized training programs. And there was a lot of confusion as to how to adopt this technology and how to safely adopt this technology during the training period of the fellows and trainees. The endoscopic surgery is ideal for endocrine surgery because of the small size of the tumors. And you would agree with me that for a small tumor like this, you would not like to give a patient a big incision like this, and rather would give them keyhole incisions like these. And therefore, endoscopic surgery is ideal for endocrine surgical cases. Now, this is the outline of my talk, and I would like to share with you my experience with laparoscopic adenolectomy, the technique I utilize, and a bit about the training that is necessary for imparting to fellows. I'll also talk about minimal invasive surgery, especially endoscopic thyroidectomy and robotic thyroidectomy. During my experience from 1997 to 2021, almost 24 years, I've had 150 adenolectomies, out of which almost 30% have been laparoscopic adenolectomies. This is, I would admit, a modest experience of adenolectomies. And this is the year-wise distribution of laparoscopic adenolectomies. And this is on the basis of the pathology. And you would see that maximum laparoscopic adenolectomies have been for pheochromocytomas, followed by Kahn's adenoma, and then for adrenal cyst and Cushing's adenoma. There have been few cases of myelolipoma and non-functioning adenomas. Now, laparoscopic adenolectomy has now become the standard of choice of benign adrenal lesions. Everybody is aware of the advantages in terms of blood loss, operative time, less operative pain, and less hospital stay, which is undisputed. Though there are many approaches to perform laparoscopic adenolectomy, but the gold standard has been the lateral transperitoneal approach, which is adopted by majority of surgeons around the world. In our center, the first laparoscopic procedures were performed way back in 1996 with the use of the lateral approach, and which in turn formed the basis of our education and training. Being a high volume center for endocrine cases, the learning curve was shortened, as I want to share with you in my subsequent talk. A few words about technique of laparoscopic adenolectomy. We follow an open approach to create a pneumoperitoneum, and usually three ports on the left side and four ports on the right side with an additional port for liver retract. So this is the approach on the right side, and this is on the left side. When we come to right adrenalectomy, I think just to recapitulate the various steps, I'll quickly go through them. My first step is to divide the right triangular ligament, and by blunt dissection, push away the colon and the duodenum, as depicted in this diagram. And then I open up the posterior peritoneum. This is the posterior peritoneum between the adrenal tumor and the liver, and starting from the triangular ligament to the inferior vena cava medially. This is commonly referred to as a C-shaped incision or a hook-shaped incision. And it's important that the liver is retracted properly by the assistant. Now, once the posterior peritoneum is opened up, next step, and this is the most important part of the adrenalectomy, is opening up the superior medial side of the adrenal. So you develop a plane between the kidney and tumor and the IVC on the medial side. And the right adrenal vein is then typically encountered just inferior to where the IVC enters the liver. And this is the commonest location, but I must admit that the position may vary, and sometimes it is rather higher up. And unless the liver is retracted properly, you may not be able to visualize the adrenal vein. And then the adrenal vein is clipped, usually using a hemolock or a metal clips, two on the IVC side and two on the tumor side. Again, I'd like to emphasize that approximately 15 to 20% of cases, you may get an accessory adrenal vein, which is usually above the main adrenal vein. So once you have ligated the main adrenal vein, you should always be on the lookout for an accessory vein, which may be a source of bleeding if it is inadvertently injured. And then, of course, the inferior medial side of the gland is dissected away from the upper pole of the kidney. And it's important to identify if there are any superior pole renal arteries or an aberrant superior pole renal artery. So it's important that you move in a very structured manner, starting from the lateral side, then you go to the superior medial side, and then the inferior medial, and then the inferior lateral. So if a clear-cut plan of dissection is followed, then the adrenalectomy becomes easier. Coming to the left adrenalectomy, a surgeon must be aware of the various ligaments, which are very important on this side, unlike the right triangular ligament only on the right side. Here you will encounter the splenopancreatic ligament, and you will encounter the splenocolic ligament. So unless you cut these ligaments, you will not be able to visualize the adrenal tumor. So the first step is to cut the splenopancreatic ligament, then the splenocolic ligament, and then the most important is the splenoparietal ligament, which is cut on the lateral side. So once this ligament is cut, then the spleen would fall medially, exposing the adrenal tumor. So you cut the splenopancreatic ligament, splenocolic ligament, and the phrenicocolic or the splenophrenico ligament. And once you cut all these ligaments, this is the kind of picture that you will get when the adrenal tumor lies in front of you, the pancreatic tail is pushed away, the spleen lies medially, and the kidney is pushed inferiorly. So the next step is to find the left renal vein, and what I do is to start from the lateral side or the lateral edge of the adrenal gland, and then successively separate it from the kidney. And then you would encounter the adrenal vein on the inferior medial side. So the dissection is done from a lateral to the medial side to encounter the adrenal vein. Alternatively, you can follow the inferior phrenic vein, which drains into the renal vein on the medial side of the tumor. And then you will encounter the adrenal vein joining the renal vein very close to where the phrenic vein is joining the renal vein. So this is an alternative method of dissection which may be followed. And then the adrenal upper pole is dissected along the hanging technique, and adrenal is then retrieved in a retrieval bag through the 10 to 12 millimeter trocar. So some pictures to depict these. This is a case of Kahn's adenoma, which was removed laparoscopically. You can see the very nice bright yellow Kahn's adenoma. And this is the post-operative picture of the patient. Right-sided by he used four ports. This is for the liver retractor, and these for the camera and the retractors. This is a case of a pheochromocytoma in a young girl, which is around 4 into 4 centimeters, which was removed laparoscopically. This is a young girl of Cushing's disease, Cushing's syndrome, and this was a 5 into 5 centimeter adenoma that was removed laparoscopically. There's another lady who presented with the features of Cushing's, and an adenoma around 4 into 4 centimeters was removed laparoscopically. Interestingly, this lady had a thrombus in the adrenal vein, and we could still clip the adrenal vein distal to the thrombus, taking the thrombus along with the specimen. And this is the specimen, and interestingly and unfortunately for the patient, it turned out to be a benign adenoma despite the thrombosis in the adrenal vein. This is the thrombosis in the adrenal vein. Now, the second part of my talk is focused on training in laparoscopic technique, which is a very important aspect in academic institutes. Before I go on to these are some very interesting figures that more than 90% of all adenectomies are performed by surgeons whose endocrine operations account for less than 25% surgical practice. Of course, these are the American figures. And surgeons who operate, who are mostly endocrine operations, only 3% of their practice is made up of adenectomies. And therefore, most strikingly, 50% of all adenectomies are performed by surgeons whose annual operations of adenectomy are only one or two. So these figures reflect that there's an urgent need for training of residents who are engaged in endocrine surgery, and there is a role of dedicated centers to perform adenectomy operations to train the residents in the area of laparoscopic adenectomy. We must also realize that commonly world over, the advanced laparoscopic procedures such as adenectomy usually is started after the fellow or the trainee has gone through less complex procedures such as laparoscopic cholecystectomy, laparoscopic appendicectomy, or laparoscopic hernia repair. But unfortunately, it may not be true for centers, endocrine centers, where the residents or fellows may not have had an experience in these less complex laparoscopic procedures. The term learning curve typically describes a graph that the proficiency in a specific task is measured over time, and we talk about learning curve in almost all surgical procedures, more so in laparoscopic procedures. Now, there are four very important factors that affect the learning curve. It is the operative time, it's the size of the tumor, it is the site of the tumor, and the pathology of the tumor. This is particularly applicable to laparoscopic adenectomy, the learning curve in laparoscopic adenectomy. This was an interesting paper by David who showed that there was a significant reduction in mean operative time and in intraoperative complications as the learner proceeds through his learning curve. And they also suggested that the learning curve flattens after approximately 30 cases of laparoscopic adenectomy. This researcher established that the learning curve flattened at 20 cases. And this study showed that the operative time did not decrease in the series in contrast with complication rate and blood loss. So there was a reduction in complication rate, reduction in blood loss, but the operative time did decrease. So you would see that there are conflicting reports in literature as far as the operative time is concerned. But nonetheless, the learning curve lies somewhere between 20 to 40 cases. There are various studies which have shown that the adrenal lesions, which are larger than 8 to 10 centimeter, can be challenging to resect because they require gentle handling and because of the proximity to adjacent organs. As far as pathology is concerned, it is now established fact that laparoscopic adenectomy for a aldosterone-producing Cone's adenoma is less challenging when compared to surgery for a pheochromocytoma or a Cushing's adenoma. And there are studies by Paulin and Ito et al. Which have shown that during the learning phase, it is better not to perform laparoscopic adenectomy for pheochromocytoma, and one should go in for a Cone's adenoma and then subsequently a Cushing's adenoma, but perhaps not operate on a pheochromocytoma. Now, size of the lesion also affects the learning curve because laparoscopic adenectomy performed on the right or left side are different procedures because of the different anatomical relationship. The right adrenal vein is very short and empties into the vena cava. On the other side, left side, the typical adrenal vein is actually into the renal vein. So this study by Sommer et al. Proposed that during the learning curve, adrenalectomy should be trained, the fellow should be trained in laparoscopic adrenalectomy on the left side and not on the right side. So if for beginners, it's very important to choose a left adrenalectomy during the training period. Last but not the least, of course, is the surgeon experience. That is very important. And Ito et al. Have reported that there's a shorter learning curve for surgeons after participating in at least 10 procedures as assistant surgeon. Whereas Sombri et al. Claimed that residents should be supervised by an experienced surgeon for at least 30 procedures. So surgeons, if they participated as assistant surgeon in 10 procedures, and residents to be participating in at least 30 procedures. Now, during my experience, you know, I always considered, of course, left adrenalectomy as the best procedure for trainees. As I mentioned, there is an increased risk of bleeding on the right side from the IVC. More time is needed to find the adrenal vein on the right side. And importantly, there are more variations in the venous anatomy on the right side. For example, the presence of an accessory adrenal vein, or there may be a hepatic vein, which may result in hemorrhage and inadvertent damage. As far as pathology is concerned, of course, as for the other studies, I also found that small tumors in Kahn's adenoma are the easiest for trainees. Cushing's adenoma can be difficult because of excessive fat, and sometimes may be very difficult to even locate the adrenal tumor if they're small and the patient is very fatty. And Cushing's tumors are also friable, very difficult to handle. As far as pheochromocytoma is concerned, they are difficult tumors because there's a lot of hypervascularity. There may be bleeding from tumor, and their right adrenal vein, as I mentioned, is small, it is wide, and usually joins posterior to the IVC. Now, this is very important. On the right side, the tumors tend to burrow posteriorly to IVC, and this may pose some degree of challenge during a laparoscopic adrenalectomy. There may be an accessory hepatic vein. But the advantage with pheochromocytoma, these tumors are rather firm, and therefore it's easier to handle with your laparoscopic retractors. So this is the kind of difference I found in the three pathologies that are most commonly used undergo laparoscopic adrenalectomy. There may be various reasons of conversion. In my series, it was mostly because of difficulty in dissection due to limited space. Sometimes bleeding due to inadvertent damage, especially to the adrenal gland, and because of adhesions of previous surgery. And the most common cause for conversion was a pheochromocytoma. And this is a chart showing 9 conversions in my series. And as you would see, the commonest cause is a pheochromocytoma, though they were rather bigger, 8 centimeters, and this was like 11 centimeters. And bleeding was the most common cause, and difficulty in mobilizing these big tumors was the cause of conversion. But sometimes causes like, in this case, the transverse colon was densely adherent to the liver and could not be dissected off, led to the conversion. So there may be different reasons, but pheochromocytoma was the commonest cause out of 9 cases in there. 7 cases, it was the cause of conversion. So in my during my training period, I kept the size initially as 4 centimeters, then moved to 6 centimeters, and then 8 centimeters. 8 centimeters was like an outer limit for majority of the tumors if I had to operate them laparoscopically. One or two interesting facts during laparoscopic surgery, you know, it is suggested that pneumoperitoneum, at the time of induction pneumoperitoneum, there may be increase of catecholamines. And there may be intraoperative hemodynamic changes, but in our cases, except for one case in which the patient developed bradycardia, the pneumoperitoneum did not pose any significant issues. Another important debate in laparoscopic adrenalectomy, especially for pheochromocytoma, is that whether one should take the adrenal vein first or adrenal vein last. People who suggest that vein should be taken early on argue that if you take ligate the vein early, there may be very little hemodynamic changes. But I, as most of other surgeons, follow the policy of ligating the vein last, and I did not find that the rate of hemodynamic alterations were more in cases where the vein was taken last. But that's my policy. Now, this is a very interesting graph, and I like your attention on this graph. This is actually a way of cumulative sum analysis of laparoscopic cases, where the cases are put in chronological order as you go along the learning curve. And if you see this dotted line here, ends at operation number 9, which ends the learning period, and there it is plateaued here, so the period of acquiring competence starts. And if you see this dotted line, this is at case number 19 or maybe 18, where the period of acquiring competence ends and the period of mastering commences, where the operative times on the this axis is the operative time and the size of the tumor, and here is the case's chronological order. So after 18th case, there was a decrease in the operative time and the increase in the size of the tumor. So this is kind of reflects a learning curve of a laparoscopic surgery, which might be a little different, because in other series, this line may be perhaps somewhere here, and this line may be shifted again on the right side. As I mentioned, usually the learning curve is between 20 to 30 cases. Now, moving on to the other aspect of my talk, the other important minimally invasive procedure that is followed by endocrine surgeons is the minimal access thyroid surgery. And you know, the traditional thyroidectomy technique produces a long scar on the neck that is so difficult to conceal. And in countries like India and other Asian countries, there is a greater cultural sensitivity to the anterior neck scars. And therefore, there was development of alternative approaches, mostly driven by patient-centered efforts to improve cosmetic impact of thyroid surgery. And these approaches actually developed along two avenues of innovation. One was the minimally invasive anterior cervical approaches, and the other was the remote access approaches. The minimally invasive anterior cervical approaches most commonly were the MIVAT and the MINET. The MIVAT was popularized by Paolo Micoli from Pisa, Italy. But our South Asian friends, especially from Korea, the major emphasis was using a remote access approach, which could be either a chest or a breast approach or axillary approach. And mostly it was a combined chest and axillary approach. Whereas in North America, the post-auricular approach became more common. And recently, the oral cavity approach has now also been popularized, especially by Anu Wong from Southeast Asia. So a word about evolution of endoscopic surgery in SGPGI. The first endoscopic neck operation was a parathyroidectomy, which I performed through a chest and axillary approach for a 47-year-old lady who had an adenoma localized on the right side. And I used a chest and a breast approach. So this was the first case of parathyroidectomy or a minimally invasive neck procedure. These are the scars after 2 weeks. Subsequently, endoscopic thyroid surgery was performed by myself and my colleagues in the department using the chest and axillary approach, followed by the breast and axillary approach, and then the barber approach. And though I haven't performed the transoral approach, my colleagues have been performing the transoral approach. So this is the ABA approach. This is the kind of dissection that is needed, and this is the post-operative scars. I must also thank my colleagues, especially Dr. Lee from Seoul, who supported and collaborated with me and encouraged me to take up the BABA approach, especially after attending the proctorship program supported by the ISOPS. And also the biennial meeting of the International Society of ISOPS was held here last year, where a robotic thyroidectomy was performed. So after the ABA approach, the BABA approach was taken up by me. And the robotic, so Once the endoscopic approach was taken up, the next logical step was to take up the robotic technology because of the potential advantages like more precise dissection, improved visualization, some surgeon-controlled visualization, and hand tremor filtering system. All these advantages are there for the surgeon as well as for the patient. So once the robotic technology became available in SGPGI, there was a mentoring program that was set up. So the first surgery which I performed was a robotic axillary thyroidectomy, which is the Chung's approach, popularized by Dr. Chung from Seoul. This was a lady who had a right-sided thyroid nodule, and this is the head end, and this is the axillary approach to the thyroid nodule. It's a good idea to use headlight because then you can dissect and raise the flaps easily. And this is the Chung's retractor, which is a special retractor which is needed for the axillary approach, and the robotic being docked on the tumor. And this is the hemithyroidectomy specimen that is. And this is the post-operative scar patient, which fades over the next few months. Then moving on from ABA approach or axillary approach to the bilateral axillo breast approach. And this is the preparation for raising the flaps, and this represents the various. So there are two incisions, one on the axilla on either side and one on the areola on the either side. And you can see the trocars being placed here. The endoscopic raising of the flaps is being done here. However, the BABA approach, despite having numerous advantages, has the disadvantage of using or requiring the raising of flaps by endoscopic method. Now, this is the rabbit approach, which is the robotic-assisted breast axillo-insufflation thyroidectomy, and introduced by Naik from Bengaluru. And it is the approach that provides a symmetrical view of both the thyroid lobes for optimal visualization and dissection of vital structures. And the interesting thing is that it almost closely resembles that of conventional open thyroidectomy. So it's as if you're operating through an open approach. Now, there are several advantages of this approach. Is the most important thing is that instead of using endoscopic dissection for the flaps, that the flaps are raised under vision. The initial part and the later part of the flap is done robotically. I will explain that in a minute. The advantages technique helps in maintaining the specimen integrity. It has the largest operative angles between the instruments that can distinctly prevent the instrument crowding or fighting. And the cosmesis is achieved through four or five separate small incisions. No redocking is required, as both lobes can be approached by single docking. And it does not require any special retractors, and therefore the cost is brought down. So there are some advantages of over the axillary approach of not requiring a special retractor and giving small incisions, and some advantage over the BABA approach for the surgeon in not having to raise the flaps endoscopically. So as I mentioned, this is very similar to BABA technique, but the flaps are elevated under vision, and late last part of the flap elevation is done with the robotic dissection. So this is a young lady with a solitary thyroid nodule, and you can see the axillary incision is given and the flaps are raised under vision. So you can see going deep inside the chest, and retractors are here where the flaps are raised under vision. So this is the long cautery tip that the flaps are raised. Now, once the flaps are raised, then the trocars are placed and the robot is docked. And the later part of the dissection of the flap is actually done with the help of the robot. So this becomes very easy dissection and takes very less time. And then you proceed with robotic thyroidectomy. You can see the recurrent angina here. And the surgeon sitting on the console. And this is the thyroidectomy in progress. This is a post-operative picture. So this was the initial incision that was given here, which is slightly longer as compared to Baba. And small incisions, I prefer to give them intra-areolarly. So they're hardly visible. So you can see this is the left side axillary port, and here you can hardly make out the, because they are given within the areola. So there are no, so when the patient raises arms, the arms are down, you can hardly see the axillary incision, and the breast incisions are also not visible. Of course, there are no neck incisions. So this has been, this is my experience of robotic thyroidectomy. We started with, I started with transaxillary procedure using the Chung's approach, then moved on to the Baba approach. And then for the last 8 or 9 procedures, I have followed the rabbit approach. And I think this is my approach of choice. Yeah? And besides a couple of procedures I have done is the thymectomies through the left thoracic approach and adrenalectomy and excision of a paraganglioma has been done through the left lateral supraumbilical approach. So this has been the initial learning curve has been with the help of a mentor, moving from transaxillary to Baba and to rapid approach. And after having done around 23 robotic thyroidectomy procedures, I can now perform the procedures independently. And then the plan is to move on to total thyroidectomies and central dissections and modified neck dissections for papillary thyroid cancers. This is an interesting paper, and I think all the trainees should read that the robotic thyroidectomy learning curve for beginning surgeons with little or no experience, where the authors concluded that the trainees can perform the robotic thyroidectomy even if they don't have any experience in endoscopic surgery. So, ladies and gentlemen, my concluding remarks. My journey has been a roller coaster the last 20 years, because I had no prior experience of endoscopic cholecystectomy or hernia repair. And as you saw, there are very few adrenal cases in a year. Whatever cases we get, they were very large tumors, so case selection resulted in very few tumors that could qualify for a laparoscopic adrenalectomy. No mentoring was available. It was kind of a self-mentoring that was done. And I must share you, there were moments when I would say that why did I take up laparoscopic surgery? I could have done this case open within half an hour. But I persisted because it's very important to cross over the hump of the learning curve. Even though there are a lot of difficulties, I would feel on the day of surgery a lot of anxiety that today is going to be a difficult day. But yet I persisted because the destination was, in my view, that once I'm able to learn and cross the learning curve and acquire the competency and master the technique, I'll be able to pass it on to my residents, and the patient will be benefited. So these were the two main objectives that kept me going for this very difficult road of laparoscopic adrenalectomy. So robotic thyroidectomy can shorten the learning curve observed with the conventional endoscopic thyroidectomy. But what I want to emphasize is that it can be minimized by a standard stepwise training program under the supervision of a technically expert surgeon. And what a new concept of stepwise parallel learning has come in, where the parts of the procedures are taught in parallel according to their difficulty. And I would recommend that the preoperative warm-up exercises are very important, because they could help to shorten the trainees' learning curves. This is very important for trainees who are interested in robotic procedures. But at the same time, I have a growing concern about the training of those who want to specialize in endocrine surgery and who want to acquire sufficient experience in the field of laparoscopic adrenal surgery. And in order to overcome these problems, I think the patients with adrenal pathology should be referred to high-volume surgical centers, where there are specialized endocrine surgeons who have now mastered the technique of laparoscopic adrenalectomy. And laparoscopic adrenalectomy requires a dedicated team involving experienced endocrine surgeons who achieved competency after completion of the learning curve. So sometimes it's a journey that teaches a lot about your destination, as in my case. And life is a journey with problems to solve and lessons to learn, but most of all, experiences to enjoy. And I must share with you that 2 decades back, the map of India would look empty of endocrine surgeons. But over 20 years, a lot of residents have trained and have settled in different parts of the country. And this is how an endocrine map of India would look like. And I was happy to be a part of their journey in acquiring skills of endocrine surgery, especially laparoscopic surgery. But I must also admit that the residents in the initial part of our training might not have benefited much from our laparoscopic technique, because we ourselves were in the road to learn laparoscopic technique. But fortunately, we persisted, and now we are able to offer training of endocrine surgery, especially laparoscopic endocrine, to our residents in a much more structured manner. I thank you once again for your kind attention and giving me this opportunity to share my journey of laparoscopic endocrine and robotic thyroidectomy with you all. Thank you once again.